So Abram, his name means father of height, father of exaltation, father, exalted father, a high father. Abram, metaphysically, is a name that the author of Genesis gave to the quality through which man has faith in the forces invisible. And for the disciples, put a note to the Ethiopian, to the creed, the Ethiopian creed, you know what I'm saying? The Hymenot Meseret, or the creed of the Ethiopian Tawahido, or the Ethiopian church, the Ethiopic church. When this faith is concentrated upon the one God, the Sama'a Wawulu, Wamenfis Kadus, Ahadu AMLAK, Shema'a Yisroel, Yahweh Eloheinu, Yahweh Ahad, Ahadu AMLAK, a God consciousness is established, and man intuitively knows that he is in communication with the ever-living source of all existence. In this way, that in this way that Yahweh or Jehovah communicated with Abraham. So when we find in the beginning of this Torah portion reading and feeding of the Lek Lekha or Tele Te Witta, you understand, separate yourself from your evil kinsfolks who are evil at this time, or rebellious against the true way, who are idol worshippers, and come out. This opens the way for the communication with Yahweh. You understand? Because Christ says, our Black Lord and Savior says, that God is a spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So Abraham is beginning to intuit, you understand, get into it, the truth of the true and living God. So when high ideals begin to possess the mind, when the Lord or the Adonai or inner spiritual impulse begins pressing forth to religious activity, to religious or spiritual acts, Abram, the lofty one, is Ab. He is the Father. Faith in the unseen Elohim and in divine guidance, Jagide, in divine guidance becomes part of the consciousness, the Labona, without special effort when man is obedient to spirit. So when man is obedient to the spirit and the truth, there's no special effort that needs to be done. There's no little so-called rites and rituals, you understand, that needs to be done, in other words, because the spirit is there, the spirit of truth is mingling with the spirit of that man, or in the case, woman, who is in the true spirit of God. So no special effort, you understand, needs to be taken, because man is obedient to spirit. It may seem blind faith. Now, some say this is blind faith. Abraham didn't know where he was going. He could have got lost. Something could have happened to him. It was blind faith he was moving on. We need to move on science. Well, Abraham was moving on spiritual science, because the God he was communicating with was proving himself in the real world, in the so-called reality existence around him. You know what I'm saying? Others couldn't understand him because they were spiritually ignorant. They did not have this gnosis or this knowledge or this science. But it may seem blind faith to those who depend upon sense evidence. Some depend upon sense evidence. In other words, they depend on their five foolish senses. You understand? The five foolish senses. In other words, the physical seeing because they're spiritually blind. The physical hearing because they're spiritually deaf. The physical smelling, the physical tasting, the physical touching, because in those ways they are spiritually handicapped. So they depend upon the sense evidence, but it works out beautifully in the lives of those who are true to it and those who can intuit it or enter into it, into the spirit and the truth. So we discern Abram as a historical type. We can look at him in a sense of the spiritual evolution of the race as a historical type of faith, because he acted in faith, but imminent in subjective faith on the Amen, and the Amen is the object of the faith, following obediently his spiritual inspirations. Consequently, we conclude that he is a type of faith that may be studied profitably by all persons who aspire to attain or the attainment of higher life, of the I, or the higher life. Now, the Bible, the Metzav Kedus, it speaks repeatedly of Abraham's faith. Throughout the Bible, this is why we're spending an expanded study on Abraham, both for ourselves and for our brothers and sisters who study with us and fellowship with us, even by this means and media. Now, Abraham is spoken of repeatedly in his faith. He believed or he exercised, he amened, the true and living Ha Elohim, Baruch Hu, blessed be he. We are told, and his faith was counted to him for tzedek, or for the tzedek. It was accounted to him for righteousness. He represents faith in its early establishment in the consciousness of humanity. And in his life, we see portrayed the different movements. So when we study Abraham's life, we get to see the different movements, the different movements of the faith faculty. There's a faculty that exists in our being that's known as the faith faculty on the various planes of human action, the various planes of human actions. In order to understand or overstand the lessons of and the lessons in Abraham's life, by Abraham Hewitt, one must have a certain familiarity. One must first of all gain a familiarity with each plane of consciousness. And what we're speaking about here is the seven seals in man. This is what we're speaking about, or the so-called chakras, the seven seals that are in man. You understand? And as we become familiar with these planes of consciousness and the reverberations and vibrations and the resonances, we will understand or overstand the lessons in Abraham's life. A person does not have to change his residence in particular. It's not so much about Abraham's residence, because where he was at, he was already conscious and coming to that consciousness where he was at. And as he became mature enough and therefore ready enough, therefore the call was given to him now to separate and to come out. You understand? To separate and to come out. So a person does not have to change his residence in order to enter a new country, or the spiritual, the Samayawi Agar, or the heavenly, the celestial country, or the spiritual land. It says, the land that I will show thee is a new concept of substance. It's a new concept of substance. When we deny our attachment to matter, to materiality and material conditions, and we affirm our unity or oneness, the tawahido, the ritu'ah haimanot, the correct faith or spirituality with spiritual substance, we enter the new consciousness of the real substance. Substance is not confined to matter, and we need to understand this keenly and chiefly, that substance is not confined to matter. Now, we hear of, for lack of a better word, white man's science. The European and the modern science is material science. It's not spiritual science. The ancients were dealing with spiritual science, and because of their understanding of spiritual science, was able to overstand material science and were able to do things that truly defied even modern technology, you know, what we know or what we assume that is called modern technology. And here's where the whole concept and teaching of the God of Abraham is very significant. In fact, let's just open this PDF that we have here, and perhaps you can still find this on the internet. And it's called The God of Abraham, A Mathematician's View. A mathematician's view. And when this is Gnostic Gnosis means knowledge. So we have to understand this or overstand this, that gnosis means knowledge. And that word knowledge in the Latin is called, in old Latin, scientia. In modern Latin, it's called scientia. You understand? In late Latin or modern Latin, it's called scientia. Now, this particular argument or view is a mathematical argument, but there's a lot of merit to it. This is by one named Stan Tennant. And then he has a counterpart, you understand, who they kind of argue, but he also has some important research called Dan Winter. Now, they've been having a debate about who actually discovered this discovery, but actually what they discovered was already known to the ancients and to our ancestors. Now, this particular article, not to get all into it, but for example, here it speaks about the God of Abraham, a mathematician's view. It says the idols right here, the idols of sophisticated people are not literal stone effigies. So nowadays, the idols of men and people are not literally stone effigies. But on the spiritual level, what they idolize is like stone. It has no movement. It's frozen. It's stagnant. Instead, they are cultural, social, and scientific paradigms of the societies in which they live. Now, here he says right here that the Talmud or the Jewish teaching, expanding on the biblical account, it tells us that Abraham discovered the one God or the Ahadu, what we know as the Ahadu AMLAK, or in the Hebrew, Yahweh Ahad, while he lived in the house of his father, Terach or Tarah. So Tarah or Terach was, we are also told, was an educated professional, knowledgeable in the skills. In other words, Tara, Abraham's father, he was a knowledgeable scientific man. He was no fool. People think that only foolish people worship idols, but today people worship idols, but they're not literal stone effigies. Instead, they are cultural, social, and scientific, for lack of a better word, stumbling blocks, right? But Tara was an educated professional, knowledgeable in the skills, philosophy, and spiritual practices known in his homeland in Ur of the Chaldees, or the fire pit, the Ur of the Caladawian, of the Chaldeans, or some say the demon people, a civilized, sophisticated city-state that was located in none other place than Babylonia. Babylonia, right? In ancient Babylon. In ancient Babylon. Now, the Talmud is known as the Oral Torah that some speculate and say was given to Mashu or Musa or the Hebraic Moshe with the written Torah, the five books of Moses at Mount Horeb or Sinai. And a quote here from the Handbook on Jewish Thought by R. Arya Kaplan, 1979, page 42, and Kaplan's footnotes, bottom page 42, Stan Tennant quotes him here, says, "It was into this pagan atmosphere that a most unique individual was born. From his earliest childhood, Abraham transcended his pagan environment and recognized that the world was governed by one supreme being. As one of the greatest geniuses of his time, Abraham was able to see or to use his keen mind to see through the sham and falsehood of the values of his generation, the false values of his time, and understand the true purpose of the creation," or as Rastafari would say, the iration. "Abraham is at home. He is reflecting on the many idols of metal and stone and wood that his father makes and sells. He has a rationalization that these idols are dead and inert, and he discovers, quote unquote, the one God, the Ahadu AMLAK, or he discovers in himself, by himself, you understand, the one God. But the one God, we must also footnote, was already discovered among ancient peoples. But through progressively going down and degenerating to the time of Abraham, was very little and very rarely known. So the world was of one language, of one kind, in a spiritual, cultural, scientific, and social sense. And they all spoke the same babble. You understand? They all babbled about the same Babylon. You understand? This is a paraphrase of the traditional stories. How are we to understand it, he says right here. How are we to understand it? He goes on to say, if we as our scholars assume that the story is to be taken literally, then Abraham realizes the idols of his father makes themselves are not alive and thus not able to have any effect in the world, no matter what or how they are prayed to and no matter what sacrifice is offered to them. We are assuming that a man whom we are told is educated and sophisticated would make and sell inert effigies as idols. If we meet an educated and sophisticated person today, we would not find it plausible that they would be in the business of selling idols. I would say to what Stan Tenen says, oh, really now? Why should we make this presumption about Terach or about Tara? Consider instead the following scenario. Tarach or Tara, as an educated and worldly man, would know and appreciate the art, sciences, spiritual beliefs of as many different peoples and cultures as were known in his world. We assume this of educated persons today. If this is so, then the idols of metal and stone and wood referred to in the traditional story are really the particular cultural embodiments, the cultural embodiments in the arts, the sciences, and the sacred, as they are known in the various different cultures. The idols of a sophisticated person are not literally stone effigies and statuettes. These idols are the cultural, political, social, and scientific paradigms comprising the world views of the societies in which they and we live. Now, here we want to segue to something and bring this once again front and center. Remember when we was talking about this right here, the Tower of Babel? Remember this imagery right here of the Tower of Babel? What do we have here in this imagery of the Tower of Babel? You understand? We have over here the modern symbology. Now, people don't really, there's no place even that people go and worship anything little like this. Now, they have a couple places out there in Las Vegas and do a couple of buildings and stuff like this and tombs of some Masonic ones and ones made like this. But no, most people don't even know about it. There's just those insiders do. But everybody should know this because this is on your dollar bill. But this symbol really is the same cultural, social, political, and scientific paradigm that we have right here. You understand? The same materialist paradigm that we have there as well. So when we now turn to Abraham, we understand or overstand that substance in the Hebrew, the crossing over mentality, is not confined to matter. It is the idea that it is the firm foundation of all that we conceive, all that we conceive as permanent. Now, the people who built the Tower of Babel, like the people today who worship this Illuminati, so-called disilluminati symbol today, people conceive of this as being so permanent. They conceive it's always there. You know, ask people how they think about money. They think that this is always the way it is. It's always the way it's been. It's always the way it is. And then ask them, well, how much you know about ancient cultures and societies and everything? And they would say there's no need to know it. They have to just, you know, they are enslaved, but they don't recognize they are enslaved. So this article here that we would like to go through in more detail, we're not going to go through at the time, but what we want to do is just touch on a couple of the very important observations that we can give some due credit to Stan Tenen for connecting with the God of Abraham. Because he says, once we understand this mathematician's idea of God as a definition, God is a definition necessary for universality, we can perhaps for the first time see how or why it is possible that the Abrahamic faith all the faiths, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, they insist that God is the, he says, only God. We will say the one God, or more correctly, the unified God, could be literally true and not just the chauvinistic religious puffery of these faiths, and in a way that does not impugn the validity of other religions, or does it? Anyway, the definition of unity is in no way prejudicial to any other view, Stan Tenen says. Even before Moses was given Torah, it is possible that Abraham realized that this ultimate singular, or rather maybe singularity of the triunity definition of the universal Ahadu Amlak is also identical with the personal meditational experience of God, that the immanence of the all there is and the transcendent singularity is our experience of meditation are one and the same, may be the basis of Abraham's understanding of, or the belief in, the one God. The belief in the one God. Now, we're going to scroll a little bit forward because he has a lot of other interesting connections and speculations in this particular article. And we're going to look at some of the graphs here that he has as well, and just continue to a particular one that we found interesting. Now, he touches on something here in his book. He touches on this particular article here. Let's see if we can zoom out by a degree right here and line this up straight. Okay, he speaks on, let's see, the Roger Penrose's The Emperor's New Mind, right? And he quotes him saying that, where indeed does our own low entropy come from? The organization in our bodies comes from the food that we eat and the oxygen that we breathe. The question is how we keep ourselves alive throughout our normal, mainly adult lives. For that, we do not need to add to our energy content. To keep ourselves alive, we need to keep lowering the entropy that is within ourselves. Where does this supply of low entropy come from? Then here's the key thing. Now, here's, you're going to see another connection with the wisdom of the Egypts, or that Moses was learned in, our author of the five books of Moses. He says right here, he asks the question right up here, where does this supply of low entropy come from? And he answers saying, green plants. And I want you to think about the first kingdom, the kingdom of grain, the kingdom of green. And also think about the so-called mythological connection of the green one, or Osar, the Osar, you understand? And the figure that Abraham understood it as, the God who can resurrect, and which particular ancient mythology or religion or spirituality has some connection with this, and most heavily is connected today with it, is ancient Egypt, ancient black and Ethiopic Egypt. So the green plants, it says, provide it by making use of what? Sunlight. Of sunlight. The light from the sun brings energy to the earth in a comparatively low entropy form, namely in the photons of visible light. The earth, including its inhabitants, does not retain this energy, but after some while re-radiates it all back into space. Remember what Christ said, what we bind down here, we bind up there. What we loose down here, we loose up there. However, the re-radiated energy is in a high entropy form, namely what is called radiant heat, which means infrared photons. Contrary to a common impression, the earth does not gain net energy from the sun. What the earth does is to take energy in low entropy form and then spew it all back again into space, but in a high entropy form. Now, here where he has it bold, this is all in the book, The Emperor's New Mind. What the sun has done for us is to supply us with a huge source of low entropy. We, via the plant's cleverness. Now, notice the plant connection. Notice the plant, the green, the earth, the tree, and by extension, biblically, the garden, the Eden connection that we find here, and particularly in the wisdom or the Kamite mysteries or the wisdom of the Egypts. Notice what's being said here. What the sun has done for us is to supply us with a huge source of low entropy. I, via the plant's cleverness, via the cleverness of the plants, is to make use of this, ultimately extracting some tiny parts of this low entropy and converting it into the remarkable and intricately organized structures that are ourselves. So the connection that they are now discovering again, and this now can give a better interpretation to much of the so-called ancient mythologies and mysteries that has been properly demonized by white supremacy, yet secretly and covertly used in their secret society. So they demonize it through their false, counterfeit, whitewashed Jesus and religions, but then secretly they use it for their technologies and for the advancement of their reptilian or Luciferian agenda. So here in the emperor's new mind, it says the energy the earth spews back into space is spread over many more degrees of freedom than is the energy that it receives from the sun. Since there are so many more degrees of freedom involved when the energy is sent back out again, the entropy has gone up enormously. And here he states the green plants, by taking in energy in low entropy form, comparatively few visible light photons, and re-radiating it a high entropy form, comparatively many infrared photons, have been able to feed on this low entropy and provide us with this oxygen-carbon separation. Get that? Another separation. Oxygen-carbon separation that we need. We need that oxygen-carbon separation. All this is made possible by the fact that the sun is a hot spot in the sky. So, Professor Penrose is telling us that the raw information needed to sustain the self-organization of life on Earth is due to the separation, the distinction between oxygen and carbon, and this in turn is due to the distinction, the contrast between the hot, bright sun and the cool, dark sky. Now, he goes on to say that this model suggests why in traditional societies as well as today, those who believe that life is entirely phi cycle or physical and that consciousness is an epiphenomenon of complex physical organization alone, they believe that the source of life is the sun. That's why they believe this from the physical perspective. Now, this is all in the God of Abraham. Now, exclusive materialism is the equivalent of solar worship. So the symbology that we find in ancient Egypt, there's an interpretation to it as well. But the interpretation does not always mean that those who are viewing it at a given particular time were materialists. Those like Abraham, they were spiritualists. You understand? So he actually became as the sun. And this is where when we find Yosef now using that metaphor of his father and his mother as sun and moon bowing to him and his brothers as stars come into effect. In effect, materialists are not atheists. They're not atheists, and we need to understand the distinction between the two. In this context, materialists can truly be said to worship the hot, quote, metal and stone idol the Greeks call Apollo, and who in the Bible is called Apollyon or Abaddon. We can take Professor Penrose's observations one step further, Stan Tennant says here. After all, life on Earth reaches one further step of organization, human beings and perhaps a few other creatures such as some primates, elephants, and the cetacea are not only living animals whose living neg entropic organization comes from the contrast of the bright physical sun in the dark sky, but we are also conscious and aware of ourselves. We are self-aware. You understand? Have a self-referential and awareness of self. Humans have a special hand with an opposable thumb. You know, the special hand with the opposable thumb, like here, marking our self-reflexive awareness, and some say consequently we form or use language. Now, this Torah portion, reading and feeding, also is connecting from last Shabbat's with language. Following Penrose's argument, where does our hyper self-aware consciousness get its organizing information? What hand informs our special higher human consciousness? What hand? What hand? What yad? What id? Or in them hark? What idj? You understand? What yad? What yid? What id? Or what idj informs our special higher human consciousness? Question: does there exist, or can we hypothesize a higher hyper contrast between our star and the sky? Conceptually, at least, we can. The contrast between our physical sun and the sky can be idealized and extended by considering, at least in principle, an even higher, brighter source, a source of all that is, or as the ancient Egyptians in their wisdom would say, all the gods, or the Hebrews would say, Ha Elohim, the true God, or the Ethiopics would say, Egizi Abihir. If the sun is a very bright yet finite, limited source, very far away, 93 million miles, they say, according to the teaching of the 5%, you understand, but not infinitely far away, then we could investigate the consequences of an infinite source at an infinite distance from us. We can define a model of an exquisitely singular and omnipotent source. As the Fourier transform, which is musical harmonics, or what they call the music of the spheres, the music of the spheres model, our extension of Professor Penrose's high contrast leads us to an infinite pulse. It is interesting to note that Kabbalists, or those who Kabbalah, and Kabbalah means to receive, and note the connection with Abraham also receiving a particular consciousness or overstanding, understanding, that the Kabbalists understand this principle of highest contrast as the paradox of God, withdrawing or contracting. Either he withdraws or contracts, or what's called the zimzum, and then projecting. In this case, the pulse is an infinitely energetic singularity, infinitely far away. This could be the hypersource of our human self-aware consciousness. This conceptually farthest, brightest source is also the conceptually highest information, but the lowest entropy source. So the highest information, lowest entropy source, green plants, the tree now as this Hebraic metaphor, the tree of life. It is the hyper-neg entropic source of universal consciousness that corresponds to the Ahadu AMLAK, or Yahweh Ahad. By Abraham's definition, or for us by definition, by the true definition, this is the most high. This is the El Elyon, or the most high source, the Le'ul, the most high contrast source. Now, as we said, this is a very interesting article right here, that as we combine this in the interlineal and the extra biblical studies of the basic science or scientia of Abraham, or the God of Abraham, it helps to illuminate us on what Torah is really saying and what Moses saw, both at its overt, obvious, and literal level, and taking it to the highest abstraction, or as we would say, Bamarinya, the Aryam, in the highest heights or the highest abstraction. Now, here you see the letter Beit, the Hebraic or the square Hebrew letter of Izra, of Izra's time, or the Be'er or the Beit, which means house. In Hebrew, the letter that most represents this mark of distinction between inside and outside is Bet or Beth or Beit or Bayit, or the Ashkenazi say Bais, Bais, Bais. The first letter of the Hebrew text of Genesis. It appropriately establishes by definition the first logical distinction possible. And this is also the first letter of the Ethiopic as well, and of the Amharic as well. Now, below here is some of the what they call the five Platonic solids. And there's a distinction between the archetypal symmetry and asymmetry is also primary and of absolute contrast. Each co-defines the other. Without a representative standard of asymmetry, how could we unambiguously define symmetry? So the archetypal symmetry can be represented by the most compact structural forms in any given dimension. Now, the five Platonic solids, the tetrahedron, the cube, the octahedron, the icosahedron, and the dodecahedron, and the Archimedean semi-regular solids can define fundamental symmetries in the Trinity, or what they say is the three dimensions. Now, mathematicians and physicists derive the formal symmetry groups that they use from these polyhedral archetypes. So these are some of the polyhedral archetypes. Like I've said before, and I'll say again, you know, in math class, a lot of us took math, and, you know, some of us got it, but most of us probably didn't get it too much. As we're studying Torah, and we're studying the half of our story that hasn't been told, all these things come together perfectly, and we begin to understand it in its proper context, when we understand, well, who we are, you understand, in our connection, you understand to who we were. Now, in this particular area right here, and this is where we want to bring it to a dovetail of his or the hands of His Imperial Majesty. You know what the hands or the Trinity symbol of His Majesty. This could be a kind of a continuation of that particular video, but hopefully we'll deal with it in its own context. But here it's important for us to touch on this as we're touching on the God of Abraham from a mathematician's point of view. When we say Haile Selassie, we are saying it's a physics phenomenon. It's actually physics. The name Kedemari Haile Selassie is physics. You understand? Because Kedem is the proton or the pro, that which goes before, the forerunner, that which was sets up that which follows after. Then the Haile is the power of Selassie, is the tri-dimensionality of the three dimensions. You understand? So Haile is the force. You understand? Or the El, contracted in Hebrew is Elohim, it's Chayil Elohim. El or Ha'el in the Hebrew is Chayil in the Amharic. And Selassie or Shalosha is the three-dimensionality or the dimension. So we have force and form. Now, when we look at the hands of His Majesty, this is the overstanding of it, because it's a signal of the Father or the God of Abraham, and we say it's the heart, right? As Rastafari, we say this is the heart. Well, it's an asymmetrical asymmetry that can be represented by a dynamic form that continuously breaks symmetries as it unfurls. It continually breaks symmetries, this archetypal asymmetry. Now, the Meru Foundation of Stan Tennant, the author of this particular article, suggests that this form is a particular explicit vortex which we call naked recursion. Naked recursion. And I can't help but say that in Abacadus's ascension, his Urgit, you understand, that was reported to us that's happened recently, where he ascended and the Ethiopian flag unfurled as Christ also ascended into heaven, some say after the 40 days. Others might say after roughly a period of 40 years, His Majesty also, in that sense, has ascended. And the link we find is this key word, this unfurling, this unfurl, where it says that as the archetypal asymmetry can be represented by a dynamic form that continuously breaks symmetries as it unfurls, almost like when you unfurl a flag. Now, the Merrill Foundation of Stan Tennant, he says that this form is a particular explicit vortex, which we call naked recursion. Naked, should be understood, is a mathematical sense. And a mathematical sense means unadorned, without any other quality, getting to the base, the root. In other words, getting to the cornerstone. You understand? The stone which the builders refused, that first stone. You understand? Without any other quality. Or the pi, the phi phenomenon, and which we have traditionally associated with the flame of consciousness, or the Hebraic letter Yah or Yod, and the Hebraic Yemen or Yeh, the Hebraic Yemen, right? And but something's interesting when you look at the in Ugazi Abihir, it's like a lightning strike which also breaks symmetry as it unfurls as well. But the flame of consciousness is the archetypal living process of a fruit tree yielding fruit whose seed is in itself, Genesis 1 and 11, and with the highest human embodiment. What's the highest human embodiment? It's actually our hands is that highest human embodiment. Now, we would bring up the hands of His Majesty, but let's first go into this right here. This right here, it says that, as we shall see later, besides its traditional association with the heart chakra. Now, the heart chakra is the level that we get to when we get the righteousness of Christ. And when Christ becometh our righteousness, when we come to that truly on right alignment because of the Bane Ha Elohim, the Bane Ha Elohim, the Son of God, we come into that righteousness. Now, Abraham also came to that righteousness, or that right standing. And the right standing is heartical, is at the heart chakra, understanding the God of Abraham. So, besides its traditional association of the heart chakra, what is most astonishing about the vortex-shaped model hand, we're showing you the vortex-shaped model hand right here, but which is one side of the hand of Him that we often see in this sort of a shape right here, that it's one side, the vortex hand, right, that it says that. Remember, Habakkuk says that that Kedush Habatachin, our Holy Father, our Holy God, that in His hand is His power, is the hiding of His power. About the vortex-shaped hand model is its direct relationship to both our personal consciousness and to our cosmological model of unity, singularity, and wholeness. And here he has a particular model here. And if you see this, it says the hand of naked recursion. Naked means without any other quality added to its base. Remember, Adam and Eve was naked, but they knew not shame, really, but or fear, that shame, that guilt trip. Then they became materialists after that. So there's some connection between the two. The hand of the naked recursion is also the flame of consciousness. It's like the flame started to flicker in their consciousness because of that disobedience or that hatiyat, that missing the mark because of the deception and the disobedience. So now here's a human hand. And now this is showing the seeds, the tree, the stem, and the fruit of a fruit tree yielding fruit whose seed is in itself. So here we have the seed there. Here we have the flame. Here we have the tree. Here we have the stem. And coming out from there, we have the fruit. Now, the reflector, the flame, and the reflector are also identified in some ancient teachings as Aladdin's lamp. As Aladdin's lamp. And then we're going to connect all this with the Prometheus, you know, stealing fire from the gods. And fire, Ethiopically, is intellect or intelligence. Now, this says this is the stem viewed of two adjacent hands. Now, the two adjacent hands are the hands of him. This right here is showing the hands of him. Let's bring this, but as you can see, this is the hand of his majesty right here. So now we can understand the phi cycle, or the physics, the true physics and the mystics of the name, that name, Keremawi Haile Selassie, the forerunner or the proto power of triunity or the triune God, who is the one God or the unified Yahweh Ahad. So this is the stem view of two adjacent hands. The hands are an extension of what? The heart chakra. And he has under here, quote, the path with heart. This is the path with heart. So that's the hands of him. This is part of the mystery of the hands of him that we begin to understand or overstand when we approach the God of Abraham.